Good morning, everyone. I'm Laura Bailey, and I was asked to give a very brief, non-technical, personal talk, which included a little bit about myself, a little bit about what I do, and anything that about my upbringing that might have fostered an interest in the space program. And all of these things are very uncomfortable for me, by the way. If I was doing a technical briefing, this would go a lot more smoothly, so bear with me. But in terms of my upbringing, it's unclear to me what exactly might have fostered my interest in the space program, because I was raised in sort of a negative family environment, more negative than positive. And so we as kids kind of had to grow up fast, but I was very fortunate to have sort of an inner drive that made me want to really learn about things, really wanted to accomplish things and do good. And in fact, growing up, my sort of mantra was that I really wanted to be able to use all my gifts and talents someday to do the most good. In some capacity. And in fact, I thought I would like to be able to work somehow in a capacity that would serve my country. So working here really has kind of accomplished all those sort of things. But I had one other benefit as well, and that was two loving grandparents. These were the parents on my mother's side. And in particular, my grandfather was an avid follower of the space program at the time, and this was during the 60s, during a real fascinating time for NASA. And so I remember specifically him showing me like constellations in the night sky and that sort of thing. And I also have one recollection, it's very hazy for me because I was only 3 years old at the time, of me, my sister, and my grandparents in their living room watching the Apollo 11, seeing Neil Armstrong walking down the ladder and taking his first footstep onto the surface of the moon. And because it was kind of a hazy recollection for me, I called my sister about it, who's 3 years older than me, and asked her about it and asked her if that's how she remembered it, and she said yes, it was. And she interjected one other thing that I wasn't aware of or didn't remember, and that was that my grandfather had said to me, "Do you see that? That could be you someday." And I thought that was a very motivating thing for someone to say to a three-year-old girl, certainly during that time period. So he was a great influence in my life. My grandfather was actually a machinist, a self-taught pilot of like a small sort of fixed wing single prop type aircraft. But he also was apparently very good at math. And so I kind of feel a little bit of an affiliation with them through that, because no one else in the family really has those sort of similar interests. But this picture in the center here is of my grandparents and me and my sister in my grandparents' living room, in the very living room where I watched that evening. So having that as a background, I ended up going to college and I pursued work here, and I was fortunate enough, I guess I've been fortunate enough, to be project manager for a lot of hardware and equipment builds that have flown both on the space shuttle and the space station programs. And so as a benefit of that, I've been through a lot of different testing environments. And that's been very exciting to me because I'm a very hands-on person, and I like to get my hands dirty and be able to actuate equipment and work in test environments. So working in these different test environments with the equipment has been very exciting and positive to me. And so some of the types of test environments that I've got to work in are in thermal chambers, a lot of different types of structural tests, and vacuum chambers, air bearing floor, which is sort of like a giant air hockey table where we suspend equipment and even ourselves sometimes when we're trying to emulate zero gravity and actuate equipment. The NBL, which is our neutral buoyancy facility, it's a giant pool, which sort of like is an underwater city because we would have the space shuttle orbiter mock-up as well as mock-ups of numerous modules and structural elements of the space station underwater. And so that's a very fascinating environment to do testing and evaluation of equipment. I've also been in zero-G numerous times, flying over a number of years, conducting a lot of different experiments and working on developing a lot of different types of equipment in zero-G, and that's been a huge benefit to me. It's been a lot of fun. It's a lot of hard work working in zero gravity as well, though. But another really, it's a good fortune for me that I've been in this sort of role, is that I've also had the benefit of being able to be in an EMU, the extravehicular mobility unit. That's the white puffy suit that you see crew members working in on both the space shuttle as well as the International Space Station programs. And so I've gotten to conduct tests on equipment that I've been developing while being in a suit. And so that's been a real fascinating and interesting benefit for me. And I've been able to conduct those sort of tests on like the air-bearing floor that I talked about in the suit. I've been suspended overhead from the ceiling, down over equipment, and you know, done tests like that. I've also conducted tests in the suit in zero gravity, which has also been very fascinating and a wonderful experience overall. But my most fascinating experience, I guess, of all the different test environments has been really with the MBL. And I have noted that every time I've been in the suit, and what they do is they lower you in the suit in a donning stand down into the water, and the water raises up from your feet all the way up. And as the water is going up over my helmet, every single time I've been in the pool in a suit, I have always recalled my grandfather and always thought how proud he would be to know that I was supporting the manned space program today. So that was one thing that really kind of came together for me even when I was putting together this talk. So I'm not going through any of those sort of things. I just wanted to sort of gloss over things. What I wanted to say about this chart is that, you know, the aero and space community has had to break through a lot of barriers, beginning with breaking through the sound barrier recently, and then, of course, breaking into the manned space barrier with the mini programs through the 60s, and then more recently with the shuttle program, breaking the returnable reusable vehicle barrier. And where we're going right now is towards breaking the deep space barrier. And I did want to say that, you know, my grandfather's time period was during the breaking the sound barrier and breaking the manned space barrier. And my generation is more towards breaking the manned space barrier and breaking the returnable reusable vehicle barrier. And with the shuttle program, I did want to mention specifically a story related to tile. And in order to break the returnable reusable vehicle barrier, we had to have a major breakthrough in a technology that allowed us to be able to re-entry with a vehicle and have that vehicle be able to survive up to 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit, or roughly therein. And tile is a major element in us being able to do that. It was a major breakthrough for us to be able to do that. And in the wake of the Columbia accident, all of our lives here at JSC changed, including my own. And as a result, I ended up being thrown into this role where I was leading the EVA effort to produce a repair capability for repairing tile on orbit, which is the major barrier that protects the bottom side of the vehicle. And tile itself, we have about 30,000 of these tiles on the bottom side of the vehicle. You see the whole bottom of the orbiter is black. So it's a significant part of our thermal protection system. And in so doing, I was the head of an effort using a certain material that was giving us a lot of technical challenges to integrate. And so with that, I needed to have some sort of backup plan that would allow us to be able to repair tile in the event that this did not work well for us. So literally, I woke up in the middle of the night with a vision of how, a concept of how we could do this. And I sent out an email a few days later requesting a handful of my colleagues to come to my house. I invited them to come to my house and for us to work on this other project, new concept for being able to repair tile. And they all accepted, except one who was physically unable to attend. We were already very, very busy with the main repair concepts, and we were all very, very tired and working a lot of overtime and hours. So it was a lot of a lot of dedication on their part that they decided to come and join with me on that effort. And within a month, we developed this concept at my house, and I was able to present it to NASA management, and that concept flew on STS-114 and was available for all the subsequent shuttle mission flights. So this is kind of where I've been working in my lifetime, between these two barriers. And I'm now working on this with the Deep Space HAB. She mentioned I'm the SE&I lead and chief engineer for Deep Space HAB. So one of our major technical challenges has to do with radiation and protecting the crew from radiation of deep space. And it really is like the tile sort of technology breakthrough that we're looking for being able to move ourselves on towards a deep space habitation module. So I guess my last statement here, concluding statement, is that we're in this new place right now that we're working on, conquering the technical problem of radiation so that we can move on towards deep space to get us from the Earth towards the moon right now. And it will be happening in our generation. And it will be the onus will be on the following generation to determine what is the next major barrier that they would like to break through. Thank you.